News whatsoever.
Broadcast is now live.
Is it disturbing that I am not ever getting onto the main window here?
Disturbing.
No, why
no,
is that?
It's because I started the broadcast, and so you don't see the switching, but I do.
Okay. I don't remember that ever happening, even when you did it the first time. But maybe
it only switches.
You're right. That's right. You're right.
Trust
All
me,
sorts
man,
of
I got
new things
this.
Going on right now.
I got this.
Okay. So did you put out the link?
I did.
Excellent. So how are you doing, John?
How are you? I'm doing really, really well.
Once I get this document up that I wanted to talk about, but as I mentioned last week, and I think it was actually in the part that was archived on YouTube last Friday night, my wife and I actually drove into the city, and long story why we decided to drive and not take mass transit, but we drove into the city and saw Ben Folds 5, the reunited Ben Folds 5 at Central Park.
That's fantastic. And
it was, you know, I became a fan of Ben Folds 5 in the late 90s, when they were going strong, when I think the song that really made me a fan was The Battle of Who Could Care Less from Whatever and Ever, Amen. And I never saw Ben Folds.
I became a fan from the song Brick, which of course was very popular. Great song.
That same album, yeah. But I never saw them live as Ben Folds 5. I didn't start seeing Ben until he went solo in 2001. And since then, I've seen him like close to 30 times, with different backing musicians, sometimes just himself, sometimes an orchestra. But, there was a time where he had this certain, he had a bass player and a drummer that I felt were pretty comparable to what I imagined Robert Sledge on bass and Darren Jesse on drums would have been with Ben Folds 5. And it took about 30 seconds to realize I was so very wrong. I mean, these three guys, when they're together, it's magic. It's crazy. I mean, it's like it's three people working as one, and you would never guess that their last album would, came out 13 years ago or something like that. I mean, yeah, they had rehearsals and some shows. They had Bonnaroo and some other festivals during the summer, but the fact that they, were just so on and so tight, I mean, it's just crazy. I mean, it's really, it was light years beyond anything I'd ever seen from a Ben Folds show. I mean, Robert Sledge is badass on bass. I mean, it's crazy. But so we had a fun time. My mom babysat for us, so that was nice. And the other thing was that my wife and I are big fans of the opening act, Kate Miller-Heidke, an Australian singer-songwriter. And she performs with her husband and musical collaborator, Keir Nuttall. And what's cool about her is not only is she great, as a musician, but she's very good with corresponding with fans on Twitter and Facebook. For instance, a couple years ago, she and Keir did a tech side project called Fatty Gets a Stylist, and I wrote about it on the Tandem with the Random blog, and put some stuff on Facebook. And all of a sudden, I think I did that like on a Friday night, and I hadn't been online much on that following Sunday. And like Sunday night, I go online and I see they posted the blog post that I wrote on their Facebook page and posted it on Twitter. It was pretty cool. And so kind of gone back and forth with her on Twitter ever since. It was kind of cool. I think it was Thursday. I was like, tomorrow, Kate Miller-Heidke and Ben Folds in Central Park should be fun. And I don't know how clean we want to keep these webcasts, but...
Oh, we didn't start clean. We shouldn't end clean.
Well, What was cool was that I posted that on Twitter, and within about 5 minutes, she retweeted it and added, "Fuck yes." And so then that got retweeted by all her fans. So it was pretty cool. You know, I sent her a you know, saying, you know, how she and Kira were awesome Friday night, and you know, she replied saying thanks. So she's one of the artists that get it, you know, as far as social media is concerned. So it was a real fun time, and then this Friday my sister-in-law and her boyfriend are going to be watching our son, and this Friday will be a Peter Gabriel and at the Wells Fargo Center in Philly. So that's going to be awesome. That list from the from the tour opener last night, and it looked awesome. Is that the Explorer one? Yeah.
Yeah.
I had that at some point. I don't know what happened to it.
Well, now
maybe you stole it.
No, I don't think so. This was from a previous employer. But that's for you whenever I see you.
Maybe I had it with my stuff and they gave it to you when they booted me.
Maybe. It's possible, I guess. I don't think so, though. I had it well before I knew who you were.
Okay.
On Friday, oh, I'm sorry.
No, what's new with you?
So on Friday night, I was lucky enough to meet Molly Ringwald.
Yes, I was disappointed it was the same night as Ben Folds 5.
Yeah, it
I
was
really
a great
would've,
show.
I would have liked to have gone to that.
It was fantastic, and she gave out her book that is actually a fantastic read, and she read from it, which was very nice, and she took questions, and I don't know whether you'll be able to see this, but I asked her to sign it to bracket name bracket. You understand what I mean?
No.
So you had to go up, and there was like this whole process by which her PR person like helped her to predict what to write so that there was less like direct interaction with her and people.
Okay.
Which was a little odd. And just as a little joke, I put this on the post-it. And I thought it was hilarious, you know. She didn't get it. So I sat there sort of explaining to Molly Ringwald geek humor. Yeah. And it was odd.
Well, I'm glad I didn't get it either. So that's I'm in the same boat as Molly Ringwald.
I guess I was
Except
making
not in 16 Candles.
I guess, yeah, we weren't allowed to mention 16 Candles either.
How do you not mention 16 Candles when Molly Ringwald is there?
You're not allowed. Strangely.
Freedom. Molly Ringwald, no freedom of speech.
No. And I guess I can understand it. I'm not complaining. It was a great show, and she has every right to control what it is that she's talking about. And
she was there as author Molly Ringwald.
She was there as author Molly Ringwald. And she was at a library. I mean, it was really about this book. It was not about her movie career. So, but she was willing to talk about directing and acting and those sorts of things, as long as it didn't go back to the Brat Pack.
Okay.
So it was a great show. Lots of good memories. Very open-ended because there were questions, and so that was fun.
Cool.
Yeah, it was. And the other thing that I wanted to are we moving on from recent activity?
No. You can keep going.
Okay. So I wanted to make people aware of this. If you're walking around the Princeton area, you might come across this flyer. And the reason I know about it is not because I saw the flyer, but because I got an email spontaneously from somebody who was looking for the keywords technology, arts, and Princeton. And I won't mention her name just because I didn't tell her that I was going to mention her name, and I think she's more interested in sort of sharing the project. But if you are on Meetup and you're in the Central Jersey area or South or Northern Jersey or even Pennsylvania, you might look for the keywords arts, tech, culture, and technology. Or if you're familiar with the Trenton Artworks movement, this is related to that. It's sponsored by it. And so it is a great plan that they have in order to integrate some of these things. And of course, when she did the search on Art Tech New Jersey culture, the fact that my name came up made me feel really great. It was like, hey, you know, I guess we broke through there. But also, when I sat down and talked with her about the kinds of things they want to do to make artists aware of what's going on in New Jersey in relationship to culture and technology, it was amazing. So they are getting together on the fourth Tuesday of each month at Artworks in Trenton, which is right off of Route 1, literally.
Right, right.
And
it's kind of near the MVC, the Motor Vehicle Commission, and the old New Jersey Network building, isn't it?
Yeah, in that area? Yeah, exactly right. So they have amazing things going on there all the time, but the fact that on the fourth Tuesday that they are getting together to talk about these topics that are so near and dear to you and I, mm-hmm. I think says something. Unfortunately, I usually have my boys on Tuesday night, and so it, like so many things that happen on Tuesdays, they really fall second to not. I guess it's very possible that my boys would be not only interested but allowed to participate in something like this. We didn't get into that part of the discussion to see whether it was an all-ages sort of a thing or whether there were reasons, obvious reasons, why kids under 18 or younger children such as mine might not be allowed.
Right. Well, kids the age of my son probably aren't allowed. So.
Probably allowed but not interested.
Yes, and probably would be very... Not just allowed, but loud.
Wow. So anyway, keep an eye out for if you're already associated with Artworks or know about it, you know, stay tuned for what's going on, what's coming up. But also, if you have Tuesdays free, you might be interested in having a discussion with artists and culturalists and technologists about how all that stuff comes together in our area.
Right, and then I could put them on video, and then we can put that video into the... Oh, we can't.
Well, we could meet people and invite them into the broadcast.
Yes, yeah, we could do that. Yep.
Did I freeze up? I guess I froze up.
No, you're still moving around.
Oh, good. Because on my screen, it's all frozen up.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
One of these days it'll just collapse in on itself. Speaking of collapsing in on itself, and I guess this will segue into the document I still have no access to. I saw it earlier and now it's gone. It's not on my list, but the outline of stuff I want to talk about. But I posted it all day on Facebook and on Google Plus, but. Are you familiar with Chris Hardwick, the Nerdist? He does the Nerdist podcast.
Yeah.
Big Doctor Who fan. He's on Craig Ferguson all the time. Yep. He does a lot of stuff with BBC America now. He basically, you know, in a very self-made manner, turned his geekdom into entertainment mogul. He's part of Legendary Pictures now. So it's kind of crazy. How he went from just this poster and turned it into this empire. But anyway, the Nerdist channel, Nerdist Industries.
Network.
Yeah, I think it's technically Nerdist Industries, but It's it's actually part of Legendary Pictures now. He was talking with Lisa Henson recently, Jim Henson's daughter, I believe. And they were talking about doing stuff with, you know, some of the Henson properties. And at the end of the conversation, she mentioned, you know, next year is the 30th anniversary of Fraggle Rock. You know, would you like to do something with the Fraggles? And he's like, I didn't even know that was an option. You know, sure, I'd love to do something with the Fraggles. You know, they're trying to get them back out there, you know, since they've been away for so long. I know there was a movie, you know, that Dweezil Zappa was attached to years ago that never, you know, came to fruition. But so as this is to him, he realizes, you know, Ben Folds 5 has this new album coming out. And so today they premiered it online on the Nerdist channel, on the Nerdist YouTube channel, the video for the first single from the new Ben Folds 5 album, Do It Anyway. And it's Ben Folds 5. Chris Hardwick has an appearance in it. Anna Kendrick, Rob Corddry, and the Fraggles, all in the video for Do It Anyway, and it's awesome. I keep on saying, like, I don't know how the universe just didn't collapse in on itself from all that awesomeness in one music video. But definitely check it out. So go to the Nerdist channel on YouTube.
Incidentally, somebody who's watching our show right now, by the name of Spencer, just sent me an email, and he was mentioning that he'd like to talk to us more about a project where he is using statistics that he's gathering in order to compose music. What an amazing idea.
Sure.
Yeah. We'll have to talk to Spencer a bit more about that. But yeah. I just wanted to give him a little shout out and say, hey, thanks for not, you know, posting any misogynistic or racist comments.
Yeah, or asking to, you know, to see something.
Yeah, we didn't want to show anything, but
yeah, that was good. Good thing we dropped that TNA marketing ploy. That would have just attracted him in droves.
That really worked out well for us, didn't it?
But you know, I when it comes to baseball, I'm a statistics based guy, not hardcore, but I do appreciate the statistical analysis of baseball, the sabermetrics. So
I really love when those kinds of things. As a matter of fact, I had a project when I was in college where we used chaos. We used dice rolls and
community remedial chaos theory.
Yeah. The idea of using chaotic elements, you know, things that you can't control, in order to make your work more interesting. It doesn't follow the path that you set for it. It follows this path of something else.
Right.
And I love work like that.
Yeah. If you don't watch Community, watch the episode called Remedial Chaos Theory from last season.
Okay.
It's awesome. I mean, you would think it's this show was not just a sitcom. I mean, I don't know if you know about this, but within the show, there's this character who's very meta. He points out, like, certain things. Like, if it's a bottle episode, he'll mention, "Oh, it feels like we're in a bottle episode." You know, it's
which character are you talking about?
Abed.
Oh, Abed.
Like, he's aware. Like, he's aware that they're in a show. You know.
Yes.
So he is a fan of a show called Inspector Spacetime, which is a clear parody of Doctor Who.
Uh-huh.
And it's gotten to the point where Karen Gillan, who's Amy Pond from Doctor Who, like, found out about this and saw it, and now she wants to be on Community and play, like, one of the companions from Inspector Spacetime. And apparently this season they're going to be going to an Inspector Time convention.
I thought so. There's this
fan movement to try to get her on the show.
Wasn't Community, like, go to finale or something?
No, it's back for one more season.
Interesting.
They fired the showrunner.
Oh.
They fired the creator and showrunner, but it's still going on.
Cool. So was that everything that we had to say about the Fraggles? I noticed that you put up a post of the Fraggles with Ben Folds.
Yes. That was from the video.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah. So, what's next on the agenda, Brian?
Well, I can't get to this document, but let me try to remember. You have anything you wanted to?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'll start out with this. I remember we talked about unboxing briefly last week.
Yeah, we did.
And there was a Gizmodo post, recent Gizmodo post that was called "Why Every Single Gadget Unboxing Is Weird, Maybe Even Pervy."
Definitely. There are definitely some perverted elements to unboxing, for sure.
And if that would load, I would share it, but it's not loading very quickly. There we go.
So, before we go too far from the Molly Ringwald episode, I wanted to talk about a conversation that I had briefly upon meeting someone at the show who's associated with the Princeton Public Library, but not an employee. And I was introduced to them by a common friend. And the way I was introduced was as a speaker at the library, a repeat speaker. And they mentioned in introducing me that I was going to have this talk on Android versus iOS. And the person immediately assumed that I was an Apple side, that I was on the Apple side. And they said, "So when are you going to get your iPhone 5? And I said, "Never." And he said, "Oh, you're an Android guy?" And I was like, "Yeah, absolutely." And he said, "Why?" He was very biased, and he was also very informed, because he's a developer for both iOS and for Android. And he listed all these really interesting arguments about why Android as an ecosystem was flawed, you know. And he definitely had this view about development that Android development is incredibly difficult. Are you drinking something, Brian?
Yes, I've been drinking coffee this whole time in this giant mug that's from Wyoming.
My sister got it for me. I couldn't tell. Anyway. So, the guy, we had an interesting discussion, but we sort of kept going back to this idea that I was talking about the argument against iOS from a philosophical standpoint, and he was making an argument for iOS from a monetary standpoint, from a developer standpoint. And it occurred to me that I had not predicted that might happen. That the argument would not be about philosophy or morals, but rather about
commercial viability.
Yeah, commercial viability. And I needed to do a lot more work to sort of prepare for that argument.
Yeah, that's it's kind of fortuitous that you...
That I had that not on stage.
Yeah, yeah. That would have discredited you.
I guess.
Nobody would be tuning in then. That fraud, Lemazny.
Sometimes I feel
like... What does he know about technology?
Well, you know, I don't know a whole lot about iOS. I spent some time with an iPad once a few years ago. Not to get too attached, I guess, now. But I really ought to know more about that ecosystem before I argue against it. All right. So I'm going to go out and buy an iPad. No, I'm not.
What do you call it? It just came into my head when you were talking. Another thing I saw today that Google purchased Nick Software, N-I-K.
Yeah.
Makers of... Oh, Snapseed, is that the name of it? It's an Instagram-like app on iOS. It's actually it was Apple's 2011 iPad app of the year.
Really?
And it has far fewer users than Instagram, but as far as I'm aware, Snapseed does not have an Android version yet, so you would expect that to change and Google to start incorporating that technology pretty soon.
You would definitely expect them owning a product to have a version of it that would run on their other product.
Yeah.
That drives me a little batty when there is only an iOS version of it. It makes sense, though, given that it's a completely different development environment. But it still bothers me that, you know, there'll be this huge announcement in my email. It'll be like, important, important, important. We have a new app, or we have a new version of our app, and it's only for iOS.
Yeah.
You know, and it bothers me a bit.
Well, you know, up until last year, about a year ago, this time of year, I think it was in October when I dropped my BlackBerry in a puddle. So, yeah. You know, where I'd see, oh, new app for iPhone and for Android. It's like, screw you, BlackBerry users. We're not even bothering.
Yeah, the BlackBerry development definitely died off recently.
So, and then I entered the iPhone world. So I've only been on iOS for less than a year. I said it was like October last year.
Yeah, how do you like it?
It's fine. And again, we've had this discussion where, you know, I'm just used to it. You know, I've been a Mac person on the desktop, and, you know, despite some of the differences, it's intuitive to me. And, you know, I know Apple.
So let me ask you a question. This recently came up in discussing, as a matter of fact, it came up in that discussion that I had before the Molly Ringwald show. And the discussion went something like this. What about customizability? What about the idea that if I want to have a widget on my desktop, I can on Android, and if I want to have a widget on iOS, I can't?
I'm not a big, you know, customization isn't really a big thing with me with a phone. I mean, as long as I can get some apps, I'm fine. That's not my thing. I mean, you want your tech to be the way you want it, and that's Android is fine for you. It's perfect for you, but you know, that's not a big deal for me. So,
okay,
I just want to be able to use it. I just want to be able to, you know, find where I'm going, tweet, post to Facebook. I don't even look at the web that much on my phone. It's mostly just seeing what's going on Twitter.
Do you think that you represent the average iOS user?
No, because I don't even deal with like FaceTime and all that stuff. iMessage, I don't even use it. I barely even text. I hate texting.
Well, I don't know. There are certain things that
to me, texting on a phone, I mean, it's fine if you're, you know, if you want to leave something that isn't memorable or something, and you want to leave a written record of something, and you know that person's not there, instead of leaving a voicemail where that maybe they can't write it down or something.
Yeah.
But it's like, I'll always call first, usually. I shouldn't say always. I'll usually call first, because it's a phone. It is a phone.
It's a phone, but I mean, it's...
That was actually a line from Community, where they were playing a trick on this one girl, and they took her... They were trying to get her away from calling this guy who was back in town that she used to date. And so they left her this phony message with a phone number, but it was like one of the friend's phone cell phones. And she was sending texts. And so they finally sent a text back, and so she called. And they're like, she's 80. She uses her phone as a phone.
So but it, of course, it is a phone, and we know what a phone is because we have this history of what a phone is. But the concept of phone has changed because it's no longer a phone. It's a communication device.
Well, we old folks, yeah, we still hold on to the phone quality.
I think there's like 6 months between us, Brian.
Nah, I think it's a little more than that.
Maybe. But I'm saying, you know, the idea of a phone is not a phone anymore. It's really so much more, right?
Yes, yes, yes. But that's what I'm getting at, though. I mean, I basically use it as a phone. I use it as a map. I use it as the Twitter device.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Twitter and Facebook, basically.
I mean, you're essentially texting when you use Twitter, though.
Yeah, but it's not to one person or, you know, I'm basically broadcasting.
You don't DM?
Very rarely.
Interesting. Yeah, I don't know.
Speaking of the DMs, that was funny. This and I don't know. I doubt she's watching this, but there was this one of my early days on Twitter. I guess when we were first doing the podcast back in 2007. You know, right after we started this, we started talking about Twitter.
Yeah.
And you know, we both signed up for Twitter accounts. You ran off with it, and you know, it took me. Really, until 2009, when Harry Callis, the broadcaster for the Phillies, when he passed away, that news was broken by a beat writer on Twitter. And I was like, you know, I should keep up with Twitter and, you know, use it to follow all the Phillies beat writers. And then from there, I started realizing, oh, yeah, I can be using this more effectively. And so anyway, one of my earliest... followers was this PR person from who's now in Texas, but she was originally from New Jersey, and she posted something about a month or two ago, I guess closer to 2 months ago, about Joe Paterno, the fallout from the whole, you know, Sandusky scandal.
Yep.
And there was a mural of him at Dade College, and the artist had added a halo around Joe Paterno's head after he passed away.
Seriously?
Yeah, yeah. But after the free report came out, the artist removed the halo and added the blue ribbon for child welfare, whatever it signifies. And so this PR person wrote this blog post about a week later saying how, it was about dealing with the fallout from the free report and Sandusky and all that. And she's like, you know, there are all these monuments to Paterno. How do you deal with it? Do you change history, whatever? And she's like, this artist, you know, put a halo on Paterno over Paterno's head when he passed away. And he's already come out and said that he's not changing it. And I sent her a message on Twitter just saying, hey, you know, the artist already removed the halo. You know, he did change it.
Yeah.
So she got really offensive. She's like, oh, well, it didn't say he wouldn't remove it. Or, like, you said, no, he wouldn't change it, and he changed it. I mean, he removed it. And so she sent me a direct message saying, Oh, yeah, I prefer in these matters that I get called out to DM me if you're going to call me out on something. And I'm like, I'm not calling you out. I'm correcting you. It's like you posted something that was inaccurate. I mean, it was just bizarre. I mean, a PR person was like seriously like worried like how she was going to look because I mentioned that she made a mistake in the blog post, which is easily made. I mean, it wasn't like it was common knowledge. I mean, unless you followed this story for every minute like I was. I mean, it wasn't readily apparent that he changed the mural. But she got all defensive about me, you know, mentioning that there was a change made in her publicly on Twitter where it could be, you know, searched instead of a DM. And I thought that was odd.
It can be
that
searched it can be searched for a limited amount of time.
All right. I mean, it was odd that a PR person would be that up in that. I was really, and she, you know, proclaims herself to be a social media PR expert, and I was like, that doesn't, you know what, I do social media and PR, and I'm pretty sure that's not how I would have handled that.
Yeah.
I would have said, oh, thank you for, you know, pointing it out. You know, I'll change the post. Not like, oh, how dare you point out that I made a mistake. I mean...
Well, I mean, honestly, Brian, when somebody calls you out for making, you know, I don't know what her level of professional journalism is, but if somebody calls you out for making a mistake in public, publicly, I can imagine that somebody might be offended by that, right?
Yeah, but it wasn't like I did it in a discourteous way. I mean, I mentioned, hey, you know,
so
I don't know if you know this, but you know the artist changed, you know, did remove the halo.
That's more than 140 characters.
Whatever. I don't know how I wrote it.
So let's talk about this. I am constantly amazed at how quickly text-based content and exchange can fall into disarray and confusion and chaos, because it's missing what we have here, which is a little bit of verbal, facial, you know, context. And so she probably was expecting outrage at the act of having this halo placed on the painting, and instead she read something that wasn't that because she had expectations about it and decided to put a voice to it. And your voice probably sounded like, hey, stupid, how come you put... You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't as though you were saying it in that way, but there's probably no other way that she could have heard it.
No, I mean... Yeah, I mean, I probably took out the part because it was probably more than 140 characters where I said, you know, I read your post, you know, good post or something like that, but I probably wound up just saying, you know, in your recent post, you know, this one point, you know.
There's also a certain expectation according to experience and history. Maybe she gets stuff wrong all the time, or she's really late with it and constantly hears people saying, you know, hey, that was kind of last week's news, so why are you putting it out today? And so maybe she saw your post and was like, ah, oh, I did it again.
I'll blame him.
That's Brian's fault.
I'll take it out on him for putting it out there publicly.
Why don't you say something to me in private? That's what she sounds like, actually.
Yeah, so it's just odd. I mean, it's definitely not the way I would have handled it.
So I have a segment. I'm producing a segment, and I wanted to know whether you wanted me to beta it in private or whether we could just go ahead and try it.
Let's go ahead and try it. You're producing a segment.
What else? Yeah, it's segment. I'm introducing a segment after I argued that we should not have segments.
Yeah, I know. That was like one of the first things we got rid of in these days. Get rid of In Perspective.
So
this week's palette.
What?
I have no palette for this palette nonsense.
I don't think I said that. Maybe I did.
No, I'm sure you said it in much more obnoxious. You probably just said clickety click on the palette.
So, is there anything else on the agenda before? Yeah, I get it. Is there anything else on the agenda before I introduce this new segment?
Yeah, there was one thing that was actually really interesting. I don't know if you saw it, Gizmodo, another Gizmodo post, talked about NASA is, you know, actually starting development, you know, in small ways, but they're starting the initial stages of development of a warp drive engine.
What?
And basically, these researchers, they're legitimate scientists who feel that they used to think that it would take a Jupiter-sized mass. I lost you. Oh, come on.
Go ahead.
I'm talking to a document.
Yep.
Yeah, well, we'll see how you like it. Anyway, so they used to think that it would take a Jupiter-sized mass to create some kind of warp drive mechanism to move a craft through space at great distances in a short amount of time.
Okay.
But now they think it would take something as small as maybe, was it Voyager? Was it Voyager 1? They mentioned one of the early deep space probes as something that would be comparable to the size, the mass that would be required to create the energy, because they've managed to figure out how to do some manipulation of the width of the warp bubble.
Yeah.
And some other mumbo jumbo that, you know, obviously I'm not, you know, expert on. But it was a very interesting article. I mean, they talk about how they really think that perhaps within 100 years they will come up with a warp drive engine that will can take humans to Alpha Centauri in about 2 years.
Wow. That's amazing.
It is. It's really amazing stuff that's happening now, like in our lifetime, and it's really cool. It'd be nice to see some small advances in that, you know, in my lifetime. But yeah, they're doing like small scale tests. They have this, you know, environment where they're trying to create these small instances of actually taking space and moving it so that, you know, the ship wouldn't move, but it would basically take the space that it's in and compress the space that's in front of it and expand the space that's behind it. So it would basically be traveling between those two points, but it wouldn't be moving. It would be warping space around it. So it'd be kind of interesting.
That's phenomenal. I mean, I definitely missed that story, but it's amazing how many things that are a part of our science fiction history are not fiction at all anymore, including my phone and your phone. It's, you know, you remember on Star Trek, they had this communication device that did all these things, had all these sensors, and you know, we have it. It's ours. It's right there. Hello?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm trying to, I want to see if I could actually get this screen share thing to work and get you to see this article, but...
Yeah, that would be helpful. That would be useful.
All right, hold on a second. Let me see if I can... So I just click screen share.
Then choose the window that you want to share. It could be your entire desktop if you want. Hey, now talk.
All right, so this is the, you see it?
Yeah, now I see it because you're talking.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is the article. And of course, I cannot scroll at this time because it's still loading. There we go. Okay. Searching for warp bubbles. Yeah, so what they're using is an instrument. They're trying to detect microscopic instances of little warp bubbles using an instrument called the White-Judae Warp Field Interferometer. But they think that warping the space-time fabric is possible.
Wow, that's amazing.
Using a lot less energy than they thought initially.
Well, I also think, you know, we live in a world now where we're starting to depend so much on portable, renewable energy. And there has to be, you know, there's energy all around us. I think I might have had this conversation with you in a previous podcast. There's energy surrounds us. It's just not harnessed very well. You know, we still have to plug things in, and we still have to have these really small batteries. And meanwhile, you know, if you rub your foot hard enough on the ground in a certain way, you're generating new energy. You're pulling energy out of the air and of the surface and making it into something else, transferring it. And
here's the paragraph, by the way, that is kind of the gist of it. The Eagle Works team has discovered that the energy requirements are much lower than previously thought. If they optimize the warp bubble thickness and oscillate its intensity to reduce the stiffness of space-time, they would be able to reduce the amount of fuel to manageable amount. Instead of a Jupiter-sized ball of exotic matter, you would only need 500 kilograms to send a 10-meter bubble 32.8 feet at an effective velocity of 10 c. And then they say, you know, later on after the quote, 10 c, that's 10 times the speed of light. But they note that it's not the ship itself that would go faster than the speed of light, but it would effectively be the equivalent of going 10 times the speed of light. The ship itself would not be moving. It would be the space-time that would be warping around it.
Crazy. Hey, so congratulations on your first screen share.
Oh, thank you.
It didn't hurt a bit, did it?
No, but now, oh, okay, I'm back. Okay.
Yeah, you're back.
Okay.
So, are we
ready? Let's go to the segment.
All right, so the segment is, what's so great about Inkscape?
I love Inkscape. It was funny. I actually had to use it for work. It was like there was this artwork that a client gave us that they wanted to use in a oh, okay, yeah, I remember what it was for. But they wanted to use it in this brochure or fact sheet or something. And they're like, oh, but we need all this stuff taken out. And it turned out I could open it in Inkscape and everything was a separate layer. So it was great. I was able to just take everything out.
Yeah.
And, you know, because on my Mac, I don't have Illustrator anymore. And so I downloaded Inkscape on my work PC and it worked like it was awesome.
Yeah, it's a fantastic tool. But I think that for somebody who has never used it, they may open it up and say, well, what am I supposed to do with this? You know, because it looks like that. Mm-hmm. And you say, oh, I see the colors and I see these tools that I don't really know what they do and I see these hidden buttons up here and I think I broke it. And so I thought that a few minutes, literally, just to... in Inkscape.
Okay. I think your sound cut out for a second there, but...
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you now, but you went from saying, I just wanted to... in Inkscape.
I wanted to share something very quickly at the end of our broadcast, just to share with somebody who's new to Inkscape what they could do with it.
Yep.
So let's, after you open it up, it looks like this. You essentially get your page, you have your tools, you have your colors. Over here I happen to have snapping tools set, and then you have some contextual tools up here. Something that I do all the time is I add text to a document. So if I wanted to do something with the word Jupiter, I could use my text tool, click into the document, type out my text, and then go back to the selection tool at the top of the toolbar. I'm going to hold down Control as I grab this handle and switch it out, or not switch it out, but drag it out. And the reason I hold down Control is to constrain the document, constrain the piece of text to always be the same height and width that it comes in when you first type it in. Let's say I don't like this font. I can then select this font tool at the top in order to choose a different font, a more suitable font. And you get a little bit of a preview of what that looks like right there. And then when you apply it, you get your text in that font on your document. Inkscape's great for working with logos, for working with graphics, for designing web graphics, for working on banners for, let's say, WordPress or whatever. Once you have something selected, as I have it here, you can change the color of it, right? Mm-hmm. But what I want to show you in particular tonight is how to manipulate this text so that it's no longer like the font, but rather exactly what you want. And the thing about Inkscape is it works in vectors as opposed to bitmaps. And so while this looks like any other picture you might see on the web, those are all JPEGs and GIFs and PNG files. This is actually an SVG file. And what that means is that I can see in the document, let me open up the the XML. Can you see that window floating on top? Brian?
It's 11 o'clock.
Brian, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Do you see a window floating on top of the Inkscape window that has XML in it?
No.
Okay. Then I would have to share it differently. It doesn't matter. This is just to say that this text in this font is being rendered in the background as something similar to HTML. It's called XML, and in this particular case, it's a particular set of XML called SVG, or Scalable Vector Graphics. So everything that you see here is being written out in human-readable text in the background. So anyway, if I wanted to, I could take this J and make it whatever shape I want. And the way that I do that is by going into, with it selected, going into the path, choosing Object to Path, and you can see down here it tells me that now this text is no longer text, but a group of seven objects in layer one. I'm going to ungroup it using this ungroup tool right here, and now it is a series of separate letters that I can choose individually. And so, like, if I wanted to, I could move this T sort of out of line. Mm-hmm. But that's not the really interesting part. The really interesting part is when I, after having changed it to a path, I get to see the outline, the editable outline of this letter. And I can begin to play with the shape of it. And all these letters are just editable, manipulable shapes now. And this is one of the things that you can do in any vector graphics package, but the fact that this happens to be free and open source makes it a fairly powerful package for no cost. So that's all I wanted to show you tonight, but in the future I think I'll take, you know, a minute or two just to show how you might use Inkscape in order to use technology to make art.
Yeah, yeah, that'd be cool. Have a little nice tutorial section.
Yeah.
A little Masny mini lecture.
A little mini lecture from LeMasny.
Oh, speaking of which, I saw you were speaking at Rossmore today.
Yeah, you know about Rossmore?
Yeah, I used to do one of my old jobs. I used to set up programs and events there for educational things. Is Jane Balmer still there? Do you know Jane Balmer?
No, I haven't come across that name. The person who I worked with, his name is Gano Haley.
Maybe she's not there anymore. So
it's possible. Okay. I just don't know. I don't recognize that particular name. There's a few names that I've worked. I've gone to Rossmore probably 3 or 4 times. But I don't know Jane.
I was just curious. So, all right. So,
yeah, today I was talking about social media, the pros and cons of social media, and the argument came up. I love this argument, in fact. The argument was if you post on Facebook that you are at Rossmore, as I did today in the session, aren't you afraid that somebody's going to rob your house? And I said, no, not particularly, because, you know, there's nothing actually saying that I'm at Rossmore other than me. And if somebody wanted to rob my house, they probably would have been watching me leave my house when I left it.
Right, right. No, I agree with that. I mean, I don't like the whole check-in thing as much as most people, but... you know, every now and then, I mean, I'll mention where I am, you know, when I was at Ben Folds. I mean, obviously, I was at Ben Folds. I was posting photos from the concert. But
well, I mean, I had a further argument, too. Around the room were a bunch of photos of particular places, like Washington, D.C. and New York City, and the names were underneath the photos. Really beautiful photos. And I said, you know, based on this public viewing of these photos, I'm able to gather information about the artist. Does that mean we should take down the photos?
Right.
You know, and I felt very strongly about it, actually, that social media is really just an extension of what we already do. It just happens to be a lot more convenient and straightforward than many other methods.
Right. And really, I can't imagine somebody is like browsing Facebook and saying, "Oh, this person went somewhere. I have to go." I mean, unless somebody's stupid enough to have their exact address.
Even well, not stupid do. Enough. I mean, if somebody wants to find out where I live, they don't have to try very hard.
Yeah, it's true. I mean,
they're not going to use Facebook. They might use Facebook as part of their profiling technique, but I make it pretty easy.
But yeah, you're right though. I mean, they're not going to be watching Facebook. They're going to be watching your house.
Exactly, and like then.
Or they're going to be on their phone watching. Yeah, he's leaving. Yep, he said he's going to Rossmore.
Right, right, right.
sorry for the Apple plug.
No. But there was another argument at one point where, you know, as cars become more electronic and programmable and related to your phone, and as your phone becomes more sophisticated and able to control your car, aren't you afraid somebody's going to hack your phone and be able to manipulate your car?
Yeah.
And I was like, not really. I'm just not that concerned about it. You know, there will probably still be a manual override. It just bothers me.
We're putting a little too much faith in the car industry for that.
Well, we're putting a little bit too much faith in the thief, too.
Yeah.
You know, I said, has anybody here had a problem with their computer in the last week, and everybody raised their hand, and the room was packed. And I said, you know, this stuff is not easy, and who's going to go through the trouble to manipulate, to steal my phone without me knowing, manipulate, you know, the programming of it to be able to misuse my phone to get to my car? Like, why don't they just take a wrench to my car?
Yeah. Or just steal your car.
That's what I'm saying.
Or just park it somewhere you thought it was.
Don't do that.
No. Sorry, I went there.
Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it was sort of a silly argument. It was like, all of a sudden there's going to be, you know, new technology thieves who only use new technologies in order to manipulate my life. I was like, they're still going to, you know, use a hammer on my lock or whatever.
Basically, it doesn't, I mean, everything's a crapshoot is what it basically comes down to.
I said, if somebody wants to shoot me, they're not going to use technology to do it. They're going to use old technology, a gun, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
And I said, no one's interested in shooting me. And if they are, then I have a bigger problem than whether or not my phone is, you know, hackable.
Yeah.
It was an interesting discussion because I felt like we unearthed some issues that are typically associated with social media that really have to do with society. Really have to do with people,
right? And I don't know if we've mentioned it so far, and we keep on mentioning Ross more, but it's a, you know, it's a 55 plus community.
That's correct.
And so I mean, they have certain perceptions and certain, you know, ways of thinking. So I mean, you can understand the concern. I mean, that's
I disagree. I mean, I strongly resist the idea that any major grouping of people, whether it be gender or age or whatever, primary diversity, means X. You know, you always find somebody who goes against the... That was not the issue. I would have had that same discussion amongst 30-year-olds, I believe.
Granted, but, you know, based on my experience, there's a certain, you know, there are certain concerns of hers that they put, you know, higher. So I wouldn't say you wouldn't have that problem with 30-year-olds. I'm just saying that the priorities are different.
Yeah, I don't know. I feel like it would show up on the news more often. Because anytime you can play into somebody's fear about something, like you do it if you're Fox News or whoever. I'm not picking on Fox.
Yeah, you can pick on Fox.
Yeah, no, I don't want to do
that.
You
can pick on really all of them.
Not on this podcast. We'll do it on some other podcast.
But the newscast and the viewer.
Yeah, something. Yeah, it's a whole series now. But the idea that if a whole bunch of people were getting their phones hacked to manipulate their other things that they own, I would think that it would be headlines, you know? And when it does happen, it is.
Right. And, you know, considering it is technology and the arts, that kind of goes into, just going back to, you know, the newscast, whatever, it just popped in my head, and, you know, the whole thing with CNN and Fox getting the story wrong about the Supreme Court ruling on Affordable Care Act, just so I can rant about this in this forum.
Yeah,
I know it happened a while back, but it's just amazing that we've reached this point with technology being what it is and information able to be, the information about the verdict was online. And for some reason, CNN has the reporter on air getting a translation of the ruling from a producer. She says, our producer tells me, like, why is the producer reading the ruling? Why isn't a legal expert reading the ruling to her? Or why isn't a legal expert on screen? Why is there a reporter getting information from a producer? Where is the legal expert in this where they only read the first page and got it wrong?
Yeah,
whereas the Supreme Court itself had on their blog what actually happened. They had a headline specifically saying what happened before that report even went out. But nobody checked the blog on CNN anyway. Other online news sources got it right. It's crazy. I mean, the technology was there. It was in place. And for some reason, they're relying on a producer's translation of a Supreme Court ruling, and then that producer only reading the first page before he said, oh, I know what happens. Crazy.
It is pretty crazy.
Fox News, I mean, I'm sure they were just taking it, you know, I'm sure they were just like hoping it was going to be, you know, struck down. So I'm sure that's why they put it out there like that. Odd though is that Fox News even corrected themselves before CNN. CNN was like 7 minutes.
I'm no fan, but I think it diverges from the core topic that we're talking about.
It's still technology. It's the art of broadcasting.
Sounds a little bit like the art of politics, but I. The art of absolutely.
We discussed the art of customer service. We discussed the art of broadcasting.
That's true. That's fair.
And never been constricted by any boundaries.
Boundaries? What's that?
90% of the old Technology and the Arts podcast was probably not technology nor arts.
That's true.
Or whatever. It was neither technology nor arts.
This is true, but yeah, it just seems like we can almost integrate anything. You know, there can be an art to anything. The way that
we decided that was basically what we could do. Anything could be an art form,
right? I mean, you could talk about the way somebody moves.
Not this webcast, obviously. Everything but that can be an art form.
It's art of a type.
Bad art.
Bad art. Well, we will work out the issue with the document for next time. I think now that we have the page, we should be able to broadcast as that page.
Hopefully. Yeah.
And hopefully the result will go to the YouTube page.
It should, yeah. Hopefully hopefully all approximately 1 hour. That's about 1 hour 10 minutes again. We started what at 6:10.
Yeah.
So it's going to be another 1 hour 10 minute broadcast here. Hopefully, it all gets saved on YouTube and people can rewatch it.
Well, we'll see
in its entirety.
We'll see in just a few minutes how much of this gem that we recorded.
Oh, that looks different though. Sorry. when you do it this way, it looks totally.
Yeah, that's what I thought you were doing. I thought you were giving me a finger.
The interpretation is much different.
That's what you just did.
So basically, if YouTube doesn't come through.
All right. Well, until next week, I think we have a solid Monday thing.
Yeah, that'd be great. And next week, I will be giving you my Peter Gabriel recap.
Cool. And maybe sometime we can get lunch or something, and I'll be able to give you my Peter Gabriel book that I've held on to since I've known you.
There may be a couple more reasons why I'm on the Princeton campus sometime soon.
Oh,
we'll
really?
See.
All right, good. We'll have to.
Maybe, if I get a call.
We'll have to get a conversation in about that, too.
Actually, one isn't on the campus. One wouldn't be on the campus, but
anywhere but close, I can get to.
But it would be part of Princeton.
You know, well, we'll talk about it some other time. But yeah. Thanks so much for a great show.
Yeah, thank you. And hopefully we get a full version and I can put the Technology and the Arts theme song in the beginning of it this time.
We'll see. We're very close to finding out.
Okay.
All right. I'll talk to you soon. Thanks, Brian.
Yeah, good night.